Welcome to Intel on AI, the podcast that connects leaders with listeners. My name is Heather McGuigan, and I am your host. Today's guest is Anna Farberov. Anna Farberov leads PepsiCo's engagement with cutting-edge technology solutions. As part of PepsiCo's global tech venturing and innovation team, she identifies, tests, and scales solutions that drive growth and unlock value for PepsiCo. Prior to joining PepsiCo, Anna was senior executive in Israel's largest holdings company. Anna led the company's emerging growth engine as head of corporate strategy, investments, and planning. She launched her career at Procter & Gamble. At PG, Anna worked across multiple finance disciplines, including operations, commerce, design of growth strategies, and new product launches. Anna, welcome to Intel on AI.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Heather, for having me. It is so weird to hear your own bio being read to you.
And it's very impressive. You should have a pat on the back. We've got a series of questions here, so I'm going to launch in if you're ready.
Perfect.
Great. So can you tell us a little bit about your role at PepsiCo Labs and share the vision behind the lab and how it's driving innovation with PepsiCo?
Absolutely. So I lead PepsiCo Labs, which is our global innovation and venturing arm. Our mission is very simple. We try to keep it simple. We connect the best startups in the world with real challenges that PepsiCo has. We don't look at innovation. We don't do technology for the sake of technology. We look at solutions that we can implement that can improve the way we make, move, and sell our products. So that's kind of what we do. In many ways, we're kind of the bridge between startups and PepsiCo. So trying to balance the speed of startups and the scale of PepsiCo, right? And AI, which is a topic of what we want to talk about today, has a very exciting potential for everything that we do across multiple areas that we see potential.
So PepsiCo operates at a massive scale across supply chains, retail, and production. Where do you see the biggest opportunities for AI to create impact?
Well, you're right. We are at a massive scale. So just think, you know, servicing consumers across more than 200 geographies, thousands and thousands of touch points and warehouses and a massive distribution and logistics network. So when you think of this value chain, AI has opportunities across the entire link, right? So I can help bring to life and highlight maybe three. One is consumer insights. So thinking about how leveraging AI to better understand demand, personalize the experience that we all want to see as consumers. Second is operations and supply chain, where AI can predict and anticipate disruptions and optimize how products flow through this very big network. And then the third is sustainability. How can we reduce waste? How can we reduce our energy consumption and water consumption? How can we remove any inefficiencies at this very large value chain? And it's all about, again, not shiny objects. It's about how do we use AI to create measurable business impact in this massive, massive high value areas.
So in fast moving industries like FMCG, production lines operate at an incredible pace. What role can AI play in helping leaders manage complexity across storage, materials, and manufacturing?
Well, this is the beauty. This is where AI moves from being a buzzword to real impact, right? Because our production line, they run 24/7, right? We have thousands of SKUs moving every day. We have many people in the front line that are impacted by the AI. So every small inefficiency can ripple into huge costs. So AI helps us with, you know, seeing things that the human eye cannot see, whether it's computer vision to flag any contamination risks on the line, where it's, you know, predictive models to anticipate machine downtime or potential breakage of equipment, AI to schedule the most optimized flow of ingredients and packaging in our lines. And just an example, we piloted and scaled an AI sensor that predicts equipment breakage, and it alerts what needs to be fixed before it actually breaks. So imagine, instead of waiting hours and wasting millions and millions of dollars when a line doesn't run, you can predict that and plan already a maintenance call.
Wow. I am efficiency, like, might be one of my favorite words on the planet. So everything you're saying right now, I'm like, it's very exciting for me.
Thanks, Nancy.
So AI is often associated with consumer-facing applications, but a huge impact come behind the scenes like you're describing. Where do you see the greatest efficiency gains in operations and supply chains?
So behind the scenes, to get your favorite snack, hope it's Lay's or Cheetos, the supply chains are incredibly complex, right? The products that travel through hundreds and hundreds of touch points before reaching the store, and every small interaction matters. So for example, AI helps us forecast more accurately, plan logistics in a dynamic environment, and optimize inventory so we can, you know, avoid both shortages, but also excess inventory. And when you think of AI to model even a truckload, to go on a route and optimize real time for any changes in weather, in road blockage, etc. So that will help you reduce miles, that will help you reduce your emissions, and also get our product into store. All of it will kind of, all of it together will result in efficiency, which is better cost for our consumers, for our customers, right? We're not, you know, it's not a glamorous facing story. Sometimes we like the consumer kind of story that we can feel in touch, but it creates a real kind of impact on everybody who consumes our products.
Mm-hmm. So what examples have you seen where AI helped predict consumer demand or improve decision-making in retail environments?
The retail environment is very challenging, right? And a very great example of that is shelf intelligence. In a traditional world, we would not have access to the shelf. We would need to go and look at the shelf and have a very manual and slow process to identify, are we missing a product? Are we in the right placement, et cetera. Today with AI and computer vision, you can monitor shelf conditions in near real time. So you can detect out of stocks. You can detect misplaced items. You can audit promotion compliance. And that means that retailers can act faster. Consumers can get the product that they want when they want it. And PepsiCo ensures that we have our product available always.
For companies with large workforces, how can AI improve employee productivity without overwhelming people with another piece of technology to learn?
It's such an important question because, you know, we're people first. We always say that PepsiCo puts its workforce in the front. So it's the AI is meant to augment people, not to burden them. Right? AI does not mean anything if you don't have the right people to action on it. So the key to embed it seamlessly is implementing that in existing workflows. So think about the employee that doesn't need to learn a new system. They simply get better insights within the tools they already use. For example, we were talking about logistics planning. So AI recommendations can appear within the same dashboards that our teams are already using and they know. If you're an engineer on the line and you walk and you need to fix or do service kind of maintenance calls, you already get whatever AI, your workload can be prioritized by AI based on the criticality of the fix. But it all comes to you in whatever tool you're already using. And when done right, AI makes you, it's an invisible co-pilot, right? It's not an extra task to do. It's already integrated in what you are doing anyway.
Yeah. So when executives talk about AI adoption, the concept feels vague. It's a big term. From your perspective, what is the most practical first step an enterprise should take to begin optimizing with AI?
So I always say, don't start with AI. Start with a problem. Start with a problem you want to solve. Identify the pain point, what really matters, what will move the needle for your company and for your employees and for your mission and your product. Whether it's forecast accuracy, whether it's downtime, whether it's consumer engagement, it doesn't matter. But start with a problem and then figure out and test the right AI solution. Keep it small, keep it measurable, keep it fast so you can fail fast. If it works, scale. If it's not, move on. But just do. Do and anchor on a real business need versus a technology or a capability or a shiny toy.
Mm-hmm. Now, some leaders worry about the complexity of implementing AI in legacy organizations. What advice would you give executives who want to get started without overcomplicating it?
I would say same advice. Don't over-engineer it, right? Start with a pilot. Start small. Consider kind of create a contained environment where you can measure ROI, prove it in a very clear way, and then implement it. Don't wait for the right moment. Don't wait for the data to be mature. Don't wait for a transformation project to finish. Don't wait for a system to be integrated, because that will never happen. We always go through those massive transformations in big companies. There is always a system that needs to be deployed in the next 5 years. So use AI in targeted pilots that can work with existing systems and then expand as you go. And it's critical to bring the people along. So sorry for jumping. But if we tie to the previous question, you need to bring the people along, right? Legacy systems are one thing. Legacy mindsets are another. So change management has to be part of any effort and any kind of important technology transformation.
Amazing, amazing. From your experience scouting technologies, what common mistakes do enterprises make when trying to bring AI into their operations?
Great question. I hope that this will tie some of the things that we talked about. So I think number one, I think a common mistake is starting with technology instead of the problem, right? Which leads to shiny demos, but doesn't scale. It's not tangible. It's not pragmatic. Second is underestimating data. So if your data is not accessible, if it's not clean, if it's not in a way that AI can consume it, AI won't deliver. So you have to be aware of what data you have, what are your challenges. And many times people think it's just, you know, AI is magic that will solve it, but garbage in, garbage out. So don't underestimate the data. And then the third is, going back to our people's point, is ignoring adoption, right? If the employees do not trust the tool, if they don't trust the recommendations that the AI model generated, the value will not come, right? And I think as PepsiCo Labs, we're trying to avoid those traps, like all three of them, right? We're problem-driven first. We are part of meeting startups and talking to them is bringing that real-world experience, including the data that we have in the real-world environment that is not perfect and is very different from what they are testing in their lab, and then focusing on adoption as much as we can. That has to be part of the tech performance criteria.
Yeah, because adoption in such a big company, were you to put a change in that's not effective and have it affect worldwide systems, you have to go, this, it's too big. You can't put in technology that doesn't really suit the problem, exactly as you said. So you interact daily with entrepreneurs building disruptive tech. What excites you most about the future of AI innovation in the food industry?
So what excites me, I guess, I mean, we all eat, right? We are all exposed, unlike some changes on the infrastructure side or changes that are more kind of network related, which we will not be exposed to as consumers. But AI is reshaping the whole food ecosystem, which impacts all of us. So on the consumer side, more personalization, tailoring experience, tailoring to individual needs and preferences, where I want to get my product, how I want to get it, what type of product I want to get. On the production side, AI can drive sustainability, reducing water, energy, food waste. And then on the retail side, part of our personal experience as shopper is transforming how products are merchandised and how shoppers experience the store itself, right? And because AI touches or transforms the entire food system, it has the potential of changing billions of lives because, you know, we all buy products, we all consume and we all eat.
Yeah. So if you had to look 5 years ahead, which I know in the world of AI is like 25 years in terms of how much change can happen. But if you had to look 5 years ahead, what do you think AI will completely transform in the way companies produce, distribute, or connect with customers?
Well, 5 years from now, I think we will be more deeply embedded in every part of the value chain. We are already on the journey. We've already made great progress. Supply chains will be even more autonomous. They will be more self-optimized. They will be more resilient. And hopefully production lines will get smarter and cleaner with time. Consumer journey will feel more personalized. So that is kind of my hope. And this is what we hear that the consumers want. And AI will help us ensure get the right product at the right time in the right way.
Amazing. I want to thank you so much for coming on the show today. I really, really appreciate those discussions around efficiency and just making things run better. That idea of like predicting maintenance on machines is just like, And it makes so much sense. So I want to thank you for coming on and speaking with us today.
Thank you. Thank you, Heather. Thank you, Intel, for inviting us. And if I can kind of close with a few final words. So it's, you know, AI for us is not shiny toy. It's about solving real problems. It's about making our operations smarter and our shelves more reliable and our products more sustainable. And that is what PepsiCo Labs is about, in essence, is propelling that to PepsiCo and the food ecosystem.
This was Anna Farberov at PepsiCo. My name is Heather McGuigan for Intel on AI. Thank you so much for watching. Bye.
Visit intel.com/AI to learn more.